The ancient Greeks are so close to us that we can read things they wrote, and many of their objects are still around for us to study. The scenes that they decorated their pottery with give us insight into things they were interested in. They made images from their stories of goddesses, heroes and monsters, and of real life, things like sport, parties, children playing, and musicians. This vase shows quite a rare image. It's a real ancient Greek woman whose name we know. This performer isn't just any musician, she's the poet Sappho, whose songs dazzled the ancient world. We're going to find out more about Sappho and about one of her most famous works, Fragment 44, A Wedding at Troy. Professor Armand Dangeur is an expert in ancient music. He recreated the tune of Fragment 44, which you can hear playing at the moment.
Who is Sappho? I mean, we don't know. She was a poet. We just have her works. We have some poems that survive from around 600 BC, 2,500 years ago, that were sung, that were performed, that Sappho, who was not just a poet, but a singer-songwriter, actually composed, and she sang them, we think, to a group of women, because in those poems, women's names are mentioned. And she is really the only great woman poet from ancient Greek antiquity. They call Sappho the 10th muse. The muses were the goddesses of ancient poetry. There were 9 of them, but Sappho seemed to be a woman almost divine in her ability to entrance her audiences. And so she was given the honorific title of a 10th muse.
So Sappho lived on the island of Lesbos in the east of the Aegean Sea. And the vase with her picture on was made on the west of that sea, in Athens. Her fame travelled all across the ancient Greek world, and today she's known right around the globe. This vase is one of the earliest images of Sappho that survived. It's from the end of the 6th century BCE. The potter who made it wanted to be sure that people would know it was her, so they've even added her name in a caption. This picture of Sappho is the only one on the vase. There's no image on the back, as there often is, because this vase is a hydria. Hydria were used for carrying water, so there's a third handle on the back instead of an image. The extra handle would help someone to pour water out of the vase. The potter has put all the focus on Sappho. The whole vase has been decorated with black slip, so the figure shown within that slip really grabs your attention. This use of a lot of black with just a touch of colour is known as the 6th style. Sappho's skin has been picked out in white slip. That was the vase painter's way of showing women. Her clothing has been carefully drawn. The under section is plain black with wide sleeves marked by a wavy line. Over that, there's a spotty pattern on the outer section, which falls in flowing folds of cloth and presses against her back leg. Sappho's hair is tied up at the back of her head. She's wearing a necklace and a pair of earrings. In one hand, she holds a stringed instrument, a barbiton. In the other, she holds a plectrum to strum the strings with. It's held by a strap to the instrument.
A barbiton or barbitas, there are different terms for it, was a lyre, which is a stringed instrument usually made from a tortoise shell with arms and then strings that strung across a bridge. And that bridge has tuning pegs. And a barbiton is a form of a lyre with very long, elegant, slim arms. We see that in vase paintings, for example, where it shows pictures of women, usually and very often of Sappho herself, playing this instrument, a rather elegant version of a lyre. We don't know exactly how many strings. It could have had 3 or 4 or 5, and they would have been 2 different notes. And Sappho played and sang at the same time in the way that a pop star today can drum the guitar and sing a love song. And that's what she was doing with her barbiton. one of the main ingredients of music is rhythm. And one of the great advantages we have with ancient Greek poetry is it's written in very strict meter. And the meter gives us a rhythm. It doesn't tell us how fast it is. But in the case of fragment 44, you have, you know, dum dum dum, diddy dum, diddy dum, diddy dum, diddy dum dum. You have a rhythm in the words of Greek. Now, it could have been slower than that, it could have been faster. It would have been different in every performance, no doubt. But you start off with a rhythm. And then the other thing is that we are actually told about Sappho that she particularly favored a mode, which is a set of notes like a scale, called a mixolydian. And we actually are given, by an ancient author called Aristides, we are actually given the notes that comprise that particular scale. So what I did is I just took those notes and I looked at the Greek text of Sappho with its rhythms. And there's another aspect of Greek as a language, which is that the voice went up and down in certain places, which are marked today with accents. So where you have an accent on a Greek word, the voice went up, and we're told it went up perhaps around a fifth bar bum on that place. So we have a sense of where the contours of the Greek language made the words go up and down in pitch. We have the scale, the precise notes of the scale. And so what I did is I applied the pitch of the words to the notes of the scale and came out with a tune which I think would have been recognizable to people listening to Sappho herself if she was singing in that mode called mixolydian.
Sappho's poems dealt with many topics. She's best known for her love poetry about some of the beautiful young women that she knew. This was a new and personal kind of poetry. Through that love poetry, the name of her island, Lesbos, was adapted to create the modern word, lesbian. Sappho also wrote about feeling worried when her brothers went to sea, and she wrote about the myths that she grew up with. Lesbos was just across the water from one of the most important places in Greek mythology, Troy. Perhaps being so close inspired her to write about what had happened there long ago in the age of myth and heroes, the Trojan War. All Greeks knew about the Trojan War, fought between the Greeks and the Trojans. The Trojans were led by Prince Hector and joined by their allies. Prince Sarpedon led the Lycians, Queen Penthesilea led the Amazons, and King Memnon led the Ethiopians. They fought for 10 long years before the Greeks tricked their way inside in a wooden horse. The Trojans were destroyed, and many of the Greeks found trouble when they made their way home. Although this story is a myth, the Greeks thought about it as a real war, and it has a traditional date, ending in 1200 BCE. That really was a time of big changes across the Mediterranean. Songs about the Trojan War were sung by bards for hundreds of years. And in the 8th century BCE, some of those songs were smoothed together, some say by the poet Homer, to create the Iliad, the poem we still have today and the most important work in ancient Greek culture. Around that time, the 8th century, the Greeks started putting people and animals on their pottery again. But these geometric figures would have been an old style by the time that Sappho was born in the 7th century BCE. For her, it would have had a look of the olden days. This vase was made a short time after Sappho lived, at the end of the 6th century. For hundreds of years, the ancient Greeks would still be singing and making art about the Trojan War. Now they would be singing Sappho's songs too. Unfortunately, we don't have all of Sappho's poetry. Just like a pot can break into fragments, the papyrus sheets that her poetry was written on and copied on became damaged, and now they have holes in them. For that reason, her poems, her songs, are known as fragments. In fragment number 44, Sappho found a new way to talk about Troy. She imagined a time before the war began, when Troy was enjoying peace and celebration. This is the Trojan prince, Hector. He became a hero of the war and of the Iliad. This is his wife, Andromache, who we also meet in the Iliad.
Hector and Andromache would have been very familiar from the story of the Iliad, from what is now book six of the Iliad. Homer is very varied, and he shows great sympathy towards the Trojans, even though he's writing for Greeks, he's singing for Greeks, and is himself Greek. Nonetheless, the opposing side of the Trojans have great heroes and heroines, of whom Hector and Andromache are the greatest. And there's this very touching scene of them with their baby, Astyanax. So yes, Hector and Andromache, who appear particularly in what is now called Book 6 of the Iliad, would have been a very famous couple for ancient Greeks.
In her song, Sappho imagines what it must have been like when Hector and Andromache were newly married and he brought her to Troy for the first time. She imagines the Trojan herald, Idaeus, looking out to sea, keeping an eye out for their return. When Hector's ship approaches, the herald rushes to the palace to bring the news to Hector's father, King Priam. The royal court are excited, and his sisters rush off on chariots down to the beach to meet them. When people got married in the ancient world, it was important to their families to exchange gifts to mark the new union. Sappho imagines Andromache arriving with gifts for her new Trojan family: gold bangles, colourful dyed clothes, ornaments, and cups made of silver. Hector introduces Andromache to his sisters. They all travel back into the city from the beach in a procession. The townspeople gather to watch. They cheer them, lay out sweet-smelling incense, and they sing and play lively music to celebrate. Sappho calls the new couple godlike, the ultimate compliment. Within just a few years, the Trojan War would start. In 10 years, Troy was defeated. The city was destroyed, Hector and his father and the other princes and soldiers were killed. Andromache and Hector's sisters were taken as slaves to Greece. This story reminded the Greeks that life can be unpredictable. It was an important message in an unstable world. Sappho's song gives us the personal lives beyond the war. She chose to remember their good times. Hector and Andromache didn't have long together, but there was a time when they were happy and full of hope. Sappho reminds us that good times, as well as bad times, are worth remembering in their own ways. And we remember Sappho, the 10th muse.